really excited to have you all here. This is an event put on in combination or a partnership between WorkInc and the North Sydney Innovation Network. And I'm assuming you all generally know the subject of the evening, but if not, we're really here to look at women in tech and women in entrepreneurship. What's happening? What's the state of play here in Sydney? What are the challenges? What are the opportunities? And we're going to hear from a panel of three incredible entrepreneurs in their own right tonight to hear about their own stories, moderated by another incredible entrepreneur, Angela. So we won't take long before we get into it, because I know you're here to hear the good stuff, not to hear me. A couple of things before we get started, though. If you need the bathroom over the course of the evening, there is the ladies closest to me on this wall, and then beyond that is the gents. Hands up if you are a gentleman in the room tonight. Yes, thank you for being here. We need more people like you supporting women in tech. So it's awesome to see a real men's. It's not just about the ladies. So toilets are over that way now. We are on the social medias. So if you are tweeting or posting tonight, please do use the hashtags. Jono, what would be the one hashtag that you would love?
I'll probably go with a combination of hashtag North Sydney, all one word, and hashtag innovation.
Perfect.
Hashtag North Sydney,
hashtag innovation.
Want to reduce the North Sydney, hashtag
NTHSYD. There we go. It's a bit like a Kiwi, isn't it?
Yeah.
That was for you. So, are there any other hashtags? What's the hottest hashtag in sort of female entrepreneurship at the moment? Can anybody shout one out that they think we should be using tonight? Let's get this thing trending.
Fempreneur.
Is that a thing? Angela, you're in media. What's the hashtag? Let's go women in tech, all right? Hashtag women in tech. So, if you wouldn't mind though, popping your phones on silent as you're doing your posting, that would be great out of respect for our panelists. So, there's not much more for me to do other than to introduce the partners who are hosting us tonight to hear a little bit about them, who they are, what they're up to. So first I'd like to hand over to Jono Herman, who I'm guessing a lot of you know, because Jono is one of the most networked people in Sydney. It's something I admire about him, pulling everybody in, pulling together. But he's going to share a little bit about what he's up to with the North Sydney Innovation Network. So please welcome Jono Herman.
So yes, as Lydia said, North Sydney Innovation Network, we're about a year and a half old. I've been in the job for about 7 months, 8 months. Technically, North Sydney Innovation Network is under the guise of Trent Zimmerman, MP, Federal MP of North Sydney. And we aim to do everything and anything we can to boost the ecosystem of startup and innovation. What I say is Harvard of Hawkesbury, the sea to ride. So that's the territory, and diversity is an important point, important part of that. And as Lydia said, it's important that the guys stand up and push the women forward as much as the women push themselves. So welcome to the North Sydney Innovation Network. There are a couple of yellow flyers, some on the food table, some on this table over here, which will give you a few links and ways to be in contact with North Sydney Innovation Network a bit more. Thanks.
Great, thanks, Jono. Awesome. So, you can reserve your pause to after we hear from our second partner. Before we do that, I always forget to do this when I'm emceeing. I should introduce myself. My name's Lydia Hascott. Thank you for having me. So, I'd love to introduce you to Tom Fleming, who is from WorkInc, who is General Manager of WorkInc, which is the amazing co-working space over One Bay Over and also above the cafe here. And he's going to tell us a little bit about what they're up to. So, please welcome Tom.
Thanks, guys. First of all, welcome to WorkInc. For those of you who haven't been here before, we kicked off in July 2016. I guess we saw that there was a demand for this sort of workspace, and we created 21 offices next door. We created another 30 open desks upstairs. So that gave us, 32 companies to fill that space, 94 individuals, and we saw that there was this clear demand on the North Shore for this sort of community. So we've gone out and got the next three bays, bays 6, 7 and 8, and after, I'd say about October, November this year, we will have a facilities, all interconnected, so this is one big facility, it's right here because we also run the cafe. That will give us 400 people. So with that sort of community, you know, that sort of reach that you can get, and I use the word community because we're, you know, it's much more than an office space. This is all about connecting people, connecting businesses. It's about networking, it's about providing introductions, it's about mentoring from the networks that we have from our investor base, and it's also about looking at potential equity funding as well, which we've done for two of the companies that are inside working. But the only thing I was going to say was when we were full after 3 months, and I actually kind of put the head up after having a look at, after, you know, just scurrying away and filling this place, and went, there are no women here. There was actually zero women. So my team and I worked really hard after that to try and get them on the priority list, and now we have some amazing female entrepreneurs and some amazing female-led teams in our business. And I guess it's just funny how much a small community like this can reflect the wider ecosystem of the startup space. So it's an absolute honour to have the women here today that we have, and can't wait to hear from you. If you'd like to hear from us and have a tour, or if you're inquiring about space, please see myself, my wonderful team who are in the Baron at the end there, or Lewis that's in the cafe. Thank you very much for coming.
Just to get a feel for who is in the room, hands up if you are an entrepreneur. You're entrepreneurs, hands up if you're interested in being an entrepreneur. Yeah, fair few of you. Hands up if you're an investor. A few investors. Hands up if you're in the sort of the support ecosystem support space here in Sydney, so accelerators, incubators, events. Yep. Amazing. Cool. So we've got a real broad cross section of the ecosystem here, which is really exciting. So I can imagine networking afterwards, there'll be some great perspectives shared. So let me get straight into introducing you to who we have joining us on the panel tonight. So three incredible women and one more amazing moderator. So I'm going to start with Nicole Kirsch. So these ladies are all going to tell you a bit about their story, so I don't need to do too much introducing. But by way of introduction, Nicole was the founder of 4Cabling, which she sold recently. She grew it to about an annual revenue of $10 million. She's won a whole bunch of awards. I've got a massive list here, too long to read them out. And she now runs The Content Folk, which is a strategic content marketing agency, aiming to turn one-click stands into long-term relationships. She's also mentoring a bunch of e-commerce-related startups. And she was telling me earlier she has a gorgeous 8-month-old daughter called Frankie. So please can you welcome up Nicole. Get your first choice of seat. So next up, I'd love to introduce you to Rebecca Campbell. Rebecca is the founder of HeyU, which I meant to ask the cafe earlier whether they actually use HeyU here. I don't know if you know if they do, Rebecca, but HeyU is Australia's largest tech application for cafes. It processes more than 100,000 pay transactions a week. She's recently closed a Series A round, which was led by Westpac. She's been a serial entrepreneur. She's had a whole range of ventures. She's also, in the last few days, just started a new one. So there's plenty of story to hear from Rebecca. She also has a gorgeous daughter, which she showed me a photo of before, Eve. So please would you welcome Rebecca Campbell. And then we have Carolyn Meade. Oh, she's right in front of me. Here she is. This is Carolyn. Carolyn is the founder of Sound Scouts, which is an incredible health tech startup here in Sydney, which she'll tell you about very soon. She's also got a whole bunch of awards, but the most exciting one is she's just come back from the South by Southwest Accelerator Pitch event. So she won the health and wearables category, and this is like the hello competition. So this is absolutely incredible, and Carolyn has a really great story of going through a number of accelerator programs here in Sydney, of raising funding not just from investors but also some grant funding. So she's got a massive story to tell us. So please welcome Carolyn. And the lady holding it all together and directing questions tonight is Angela Priestley. Angela is the founding editor of Women's Agenda. So she was the founding editor, but then she went and recently acquired the business itself from Private Media. So she's also now a newly formed entrepreneur, and she's currently building a parent company on top of this. So she's in the midst of it, in the thick of it. So there's no more perfect person to be moderating the panel tonight than Angela. So please welcome her up, and I'll pass it to her. Take it away, Angela.
Thank you for all the introductions, and I have a little confession to make, and that is that I'm moving to this side of the bridge, and I'm getting shunned by everyone in the inner west, so I need to make some more connections and some more friends, so I'm really glad to be here tonight, so thank you for inviting me, and glad to be here with this amazing panel, someone I've had the pleasure of working with previously, so thank you. Do you need the microphone, or can
yes,
you?
Yes.
You do? Is it working?
Oh,
okay. Well, okay. Hello.
Yeah.
Hello.
Hello.
Okay.
We've never used it before.
Yes.
Okay, so I might need to pass it to each of our panelists as well. So, hello. Can you say hello, people? So, I thought that with those lovely introductions, thank you, that perhaps we could start by just talking about your path to entrepreneurship, and a nice way to do this, I think, is often just to talk about the turning point that sort of put you on the road of being an entrepreneur. So, Nicole, I'll start with you.
All right. On behalf of the dark side, we'd like to welcome you.
life is
pleasant and air is plentiful,
so I'm sure you'll enjoy your time.
I think my path to entrepreneurship was a rather strange and unconventional one. Can you hear me off of that? No?
Okay.
Just
hold it quite close and straight onto your mouth. Yeah.
Hello.
Yeah. Oh. Okay, so I think my path to entrepreneurship was an unconventional one and quite a strange one. I think it was circumstantial. I grew up in apartheid South Africa, where I don't think there were many options for women. I came here when I was 10, and I think that sort of cemented to me how important it was to be independent and to have options and to be free thinking outside of the norm and the parameters, I think. How I got to learn the principles of entrepreneurship might be sort of frowned upon by a child laying on the floors, but my grandfather was a pharmacist, and he had always encouraged me to be as cunning as I could be. So he gave me a pack of watches when I was six, and he said to me, go into the playground at school and sell these to your friends, and whatever profit you make is yours to keep. And from there it just sort of, I don't know, sparked something inside me, and the rest, I think, is history.
If I might make a suggestion, that is maybe if we all moved
forward.
Yeah, nice intimate now. Upgrade. You guys hear me okay? I guess my path probably was a bit similar. I got into entrepreneurship when I was really young, so when I was seven, I started selling flowers outside in front of my front house. And then we went on holiday at this place that had come to a golf course. And so I started collecting golf balls that I found. And then there was one shop in the town that sold the golf balls. And so I went and sold my collection back to the shop owner and negotiated kind of on like cracked balls were worth less than the kind of nice, clean, like new balls. And then a lot of my friends kind of cottoned onto this. And then there was a whole bunch of kids running around trying to collect golf balls and sell it back to the shop. And then the next year, I would have been about nine, I essentially negotiated the exclusive right to sell to the shop. So I sold on behalf of all my friends. Because he said that he had enough of all these kids kind of coming in and selling the ball. So I guess that was, I became an agent. So my friends would give me the golf balls and I would sell them to the shop. And I made a cut of it. So I don't know, I guess I just always had it in my bones to be kind of entrepreneurial. And I had a range of other adventures throughout school and university. And then I got a job. I moved to Sydney and got a job working for a kind of band management company. And then I got offered this awesome job when I was 22 at the time at Sony Music. And I was kind of thinking, I was toying with the idea of starting my own business or going and working at Sony Music. And so I had an interview. It was for an A&R manager role, which was like a super sexy role for a 22-year-old. You know, you get a business card, and I don't know if you got a car, but it was like a pretty cool job. And I was pretty excited about it. Although I wasn't passionate about Sony Music, I just kind of liked the idea of being an A&R manager. And then I got through the process and I had to fill in this form. And on the form it said, what is your expected salary, I think? And I'd never really earned much before, so I was like, okay, if I'm not that passionate about Sony Music, I'm 22, I'm essentially selling my time. And so I was like, what is a year of my life worth? And so I thought, well, I'm 22, I'm 23, like, what, that year on the planet, how much am I going to sell that for? And I was like, what's it worth? I was like, is it worth $50,000? I was like, it's way more than that. So like, is it worth $75,000, $100,000? And I just was like, I don't know if they're going to pay me $200,000, but I think it's worth more than that anyway. And then I just couldn't put a price on my time. And so that kind of was the moment for me, which I remember not being able to fill in this form and put a price on my year. And I was like, I realized that I just wasn't cut out to work, to do anything that I wasn't passionate about, that my time was not going to be sold, and that I was just going to follow my own path and see where it took me. So I think, yeah, realized that I was unemployable. So that's I'm on.
Well, it seems we all have something in common, that we all had a strong work ethic when we were young, and probably my story is not too different. Two things spring to mind. I didn't collect golf balls, but I collect plastic bottles and tin cans, which you get money back from. But my father also owned quite a few taxis, and so as children we cleaned the taxis knowing that people lost all their change down the back of the seats of the taxis. So we were paid well for our hard work by all the spare change that we collected. And my background's sort of a little bit different in that I started out in media, I've always been fortunate enough to be very passionate about, you know, every job that I've had. And my career in media led me to starting up my own production company. And so I had, I think it was 12 years of running my own business, which really set me up to then be, I guess, the accidental entrepreneur that I became, because I'm pursuing the development of a product. I accidentally realised that I developed something that, you know, had a global scalability. So that's, yeah, my story.
Okay, alright. So, I think we might need to hear a little bit more about each of your current businesses. So, Nicole.
Okay. So I sold that first venture, which was a 13-year adventure. It was very random. It was called 4 Cabling, which in retrospect was a terrible choice of name, and has gone on to haunt me.
I live near the warehouse. There's a warehouse in Alexandria, and every time I drive past it, I think of you. It wasn't your logo.
Well, thanks for thinking.
Yeah, I just think, wow, that's pretty awesome that you built that up that has that warehouse there, and then you were able to sell it. So, yeah.
Thank you. I would like you to think of me for things other than bad business names, but we can work on that now that you're on the dark side. So that was a crazy ride, and it all came back to passion, where I sort of lost my 20s building that and then thought, what am I doing this for? The business had such incredible growth, and it was, you know, such a crazy ride, but to take that to the next level would have just required me to give more than I wanted to and more than I had to something that I realised I cared very little for at that point. So I sort of took the risk and decided to sell it, which was a lot harder than I thought it would be emotionally, because it was essentially a child of mine that I'd grown into a very moody teenager.
So after that, I took a bit of time and I thought about what I wanted and whether I wanted to go on that ride again and what parts I felt were missing and how much of myself I lost and what I hid and, you know, all that sort of hiding behind what it means to be a woman in manufacturing, what it means to be a woman in tech, and decided to venture into content, which was a very strange U-turn, but an enjoyable one because it feels more closely connected to my purpose and I'm a lot happier for it, and that's where I am today. But I don't think I would have been where I am today without the community and the ecosystem around me, so a big part of what I do now and what sort of makes me happy and feel inspired is giving back to that community, so a lot of mentoring and startup events and a lot of sort of mentoring in programs that are very female focused as well. And that's where I am now.
Maybe I should just a little bit about how the path very quickly. So my first business out of that kind of decision about Sony Music was a music management company. And I ran that for a few years and then I started to get into tech. So I first created a business that a platform that enabled fans to sell tickets online on behalf of bands and make a commission. And it kind of worked to some extent. It sold a lot of tickets, but it wasn't a scalable model. So I was lucky to be able to sell the business and the platform to our biggest client. And then I kind of started again. I kept the brand and decided to kind of take some of those lessons and start again in shopping, like with a business that was focused on referring cafes, which was called Posse. There was three businesses that, like a few years ago, if you walked into any cafe, you would have seen three signs. One was for Posse, one was for eCoffee Card, which was a loyalty app, and then in some of them you would have seen PicaQ, which was the payments app. And then so we were all trying to convince people to download apps to either get loyalty or to pay or to find new cafes. And users just couldn't be bothered having all these different apps on their phones for different things in different places. And so I thought, you know, why don't we just bring all these businesses together, create a new brand, help people find great cafes, order and pay ahead, and get loyalty kind of all in the same experience. And if we put all of our resources together and all of our network together, we could actually build like a pretty big network of cafes so that it would be useful to, you know, a large number of people across a number of places. So that was kind of the idea behind HeyU. So we launched as HeyU 2 years ago. We raised a Series A round, which was led by Westpac, and integrated into their app, and it's kind of grown. So we're now the largest mobile ordering and payments app for cafes. We process around 20,000 orders every day, and it's kind of grown organically since then. So we're kind of capitalizing on this, like really what is a market behavioral shift of people wanting to be able to have like more simple experiences and pay, ordering and paying on their phone. Kind of like we're Uber essentially for cafes.
So I'm in the health tech sector. Sound Scouts is a hearing screening app for, at the moment, focused on children. And recognizing the need for accessible hearing screening. So I've just returned from the US, and in America, children have their hearing screened at school entry, and then at 8, 10, and again in high school. So in the US, the importance of hearing is front and center. Whereas in Australia, we have this misconception that, you know, babies are tested at birth, and then they never need to be tested again. And it's a complete misconception. Basically, the number of children fitted with hearing aids at birth is 2 to 3 times higher. Sorry, the number of children fitted with hearing aids is 2 to 3 times higher in the first 2 to 3 years of school than it is at birth. So there's this, you know, prevalence of hearing issues that is not currently being addressed. So there was this clear need for children to have their hearing checked and to generate a low-cost, accessible solution. And that's really what I've utilized gaming and mobile gaming as a data collection tool, and we have an advanced algorithm that the data is pushed to the cloud and the results are calculated and a report is immediately sent back to the parents or the teachers to, you know, advise them as to the children's hearing status. In terms of my journey, I was happily, I did a course in digital media in 2010 and came upon this idea and started developing it. And then a couple of years later, I think I went to a Women as Entrepreneurs event and realised that with Aussie, who some people may know here, and at that point I realised, you know, after getting up and pitching that, oh, you know, actually I have a business here or the foundations of the business, and it's really progressed from there.
Can you hear me if I don't use the microphone?
Yeah.
It feels awkward. Okay.
All right, I'll use the mic. So I don't want to just launch into negatives, but we are here to talk about women in tech and women as entrepreneurs. So it'd be good to hear some stories. And if you think that there are still any added challenges that we need to get past and just talk about and put them out in the open. So I think it is great to see some men in the room. It's really, really nice. I actually wrote a story about this a few days ago saying that we need to stop thanking men for turning up to these events, because I just think that, you know, we're women, we've got great things to say on our own merits. So I'm always pleased to see more men here, but I think that we need to move past thanking men. But like I say, great that you're here. And I think there's probably more here than I usually see at these sorts of events as well. So can we talk a little bit about some of the challenges? And Nicole, you and I have been this previously, and I know that you started signing off your emails as a bloke. So I think that would be a good place to start if we could, and why you felt the need to do that.
So this was it was 13 years ago, but it could still be today. And that's, I think, the biggest issue, I think, is that when I look back at my experience of being a woman in business, regardless of industry, just being a woman in a business world, not much has changed other than visibility, right? We're here and these events exist and they're great, and we're now thanking men for coming to these events, which is great considering that they're half the population, and that's insane, but thanks for coming.
So 13 years ago, did you feel there were any events like this?
No, nothing existed at all. We were a strange, defiant breed of women that decided to pursue careers. That, if it were a man pursuing that career, would not be remarkable in any way, shape or form, and that's not to diminish our accomplishments. It's just to highlight the fact that there's a huge gap and it's not closing, I don't think. I think we're becoming more aware of the size of it. So for me to start a business in a manufacturing world was strange, and I think should the internet not have existed, I don't know that the business would have been a success, because, you know, I'm not exactly like a tall foreboding character, so when you're trying to relate to that sort of middle-aged manufacturing kind of guy, you know, we're not really seeing eye to eye. So for me, it was quite easy to act as Phil. My email address was phil@forecabling.com.au. It still exists. And send out emails through that alias. And I started to get traction. And it was great because it validated my idea, but it carried through my whole career, where I turned around 13 years later and went, okay, you know, I want to celebrate what I've done, but I've hid behind this strange alias that I am not, that I'm ashamed that I did that, you know. Yeah, it's a strange space, I think.
Just ask you personally, because I know that, again, we've spoken about it before in the sense of pitching events that you've been to, and where it has been quite a male-dominated affair, and it's been in interesting locations as well. Has that Have you seen that shift in the last few years? Maybe you could share the story.
My story is I went out to raise capital for my first company, would have been probably 5 or 6 years ago, and I pitched at something called Sydney Angels. And I remember I was really excited. I ran in the downstairs area and I ran upstairs, and this woman who was on reception said, hang on, you can't go upstairs. You have to go up the lift. And I was like, okay. So other people were going up the stairs. She said, oh no, it's a men's only club. And so women have to go up the lift. And so Sydney Angels actually held their angel event, Sydney Angels. This is like the kind of premier angel investment network in Sydney. At a men's only club, women were allowed in, and there was like one other woman in the room. But when I pitched, who was an investor, but I don't know, that was kind of where they thought was most appropriate to host that event. And then many people campaigned for a couple of years to get it moved, and it has been moved, and I think it's potentially better now. And then there is also probably more women in those networks. But there is still a big problem with not enough female investors. So my company now has something like 122 shareholders. Like, I think it's like about 80-something investors. There is not one female investor in the business. Out of all of those angel investors, they're all men. And even in my Series A round, I went out and did probably around 50 pitches, and I noticed that there's no women in any of these meetings. And I just started thinking, okay, I'm going to count the women in the meetings, and I counted to one and the whole time. And she was a junior note taker. She wasn't even one of the partners in the room. But the people who were coming in with the teas and the coffees and the reception, they were all, you know, women. Sometimes they'd come in and then, and I'd be like, oh, great, there's a woman. And then she'd go, I'm going to get you some things. So it was pretty frustrating. I think that probably does make it that, the fact that almost all the investors are men, I think that does make it more difficult for women to raise capital. It's kind of really hard to pinpoint, because unless I could come back and you're there in person, I can't become back as a man and see whether it would be easier. So it's hard to kind of say that for sure, but I do think that it probably is kind of harder to maybe build that relationship and for them to be able to relate potentially as much. And there's a lot of research that's been done on, there's a really interesting Harvard study where they showed the same pitches, identical pitches to investors, and one had a man's name and one had a female's name in it, and the males by far got the most investment. So I think the only way to overcome it is to have a really good business and to have really good traction, and then it's kind of undisputable.
Well, there's so many stories, I don't know where to start. I just straight off the back of your comments, I just have to mention Dr. Katrina Wallace, an amazing entrepreneur with an AI business, and she recounted the story recently of being in Asia, raising capital, and she was in the room waiting for the investors to come in, and the gentleman came in and said, I'm sorry, I believe you're in the wrong room, and do you mind leaving? And she was like, no, I'm definitely in the right place. And he was almost insisted that she leave until she revealed that it was her product, she was the developer, and not uncommon stories. I had an experience. There's so many. It is ridiculous. But I was at the 25-year anniversary of ABC Digital. It may have been 30. And at the end of the day, I'm quite vocal and outspoken. And we're in the last event of the day, and I was so proud of myself. I'd got through this whole day and I hadn't really drawn attention to myself. And then there was this panel of men, and a journalist stood up and said, what is the inequality in, the innovation space? And each of these men made these sort of excuses and, for why they're there were no women or less women, and I could feel the fury rising, you know, around me, the few women that were in the room. And I stood up and just, you know, and said, look, can we please just, you know, welcome the women in the room and acknowledge the women who do attend these events. And I just found, interestingly, afterwards, a gentleman came up to me and he said, I place value on every conversation I have. And the value I place on conversations with women is at about 30% compared to 70% for men. And he said that very openly to me, and he said, thank you for drawing my attention to this, and I will make every effort to change that in the future. And that was really validation for something that I have experienced on, you know, on a regular basis, where, like you, I'm of a small stature, and I feel that, you know, people don't take me as seriously as, you know, if I was a 6 foot tall man. And I often wonder how far or how much further advanced Sound Scouts might be if, you know, if it was led by a man.
So next I want to ask just about the skills and the education that you guys have in terms of building what you've built and what you think you actually need to get into entrepreneurship and to get into tech entrepreneurship particularly, and what you might actually go back 5 years in the past, 10 years, and go and get in terms of skills.
I don't have any formal skills, actually. Got lots of random skills, but I don't have any skills. I have extreme toe dexterity. I know it's rare,
but
I recently pick up the shampoo, which is really strange. I'm not sure why I share that. Now you won't remember me for poor Caitlin.
Tweet
that?
Definitely.
Please do,
can I
do.
I can do that too. It's so awesome. It's quite handy with Lego.
It's so good. Yeah, it's excellent. And especially now with, like, you know, a tiny person around, I'm like, oh, I've got that. Don't worry, you know, it's great. I don't feel so special anymore. Now I have no skills. What do I wish I had? I'm really glad that I have a sense of humour, because these sorts of stories are so horrific that if you can't laugh at them, I don't think you'd get anywhere, you know? And even just when you were talking, I was like, ha, that guy totally sums up the gender pay gap. There's that 30% right there. You know, like, I've literally been at trade shows where I've, like, built the entire stand and someone would come up to me when the trade show opens and be like, oh, can you get someone to call me? And I'm like, you know, if I get Phil to send him an email. But on a serious side, I think it's really easy to get lost in self-doubt, because when you're not reflected back and you have that really negative experience, it's really easy to sort of go back into your own thoughts and think, what am I doing? Am I doing the right thing? Would I be successful if I were a man? And that is such a shitty question to ask, and one I think we all ask ourselves all the time, you know, would I have raised more, would I have sold my business for more, like all these sorts of things, right? I hate that. That's the sum of our efforts, because they're not 30% less efforts, they're 30% more efforts. So I think I would go back, you know, 10 years, 13 years, and I probably wouldn't change what I did, because I don't think enough has changed to facilitate acting any differently, but I would surround myself with more people like this, where it's okay to, you know, let it all out. That's what I do.
I think probably one skill that I did develop at the beginning, which I think has been really useful, and then one which I didn't and which I am now developing. The one that I did develop was the ability to sell. So I think I have never presented in front of a group of people since high school. I was really nervous just doing my first pitch. And I went and did a public speaking course. I went to Toastmasters and did like their 10-week course. It was pretty cheap, and I had to kind of get up in front of a group of people every week. I did like another course. And I really worked on being able to speak in public and being comfortable. And also, how I sell my vision. And so I just did so many pitches. I worked out that I pitched the company around 1,000 times. So that was because so many people said no and I just kept going. But it actually got me really good at pitching. So, and you need that. You need that ability to sell to be able to, you know, raise money if you want to raise money or not, but you definitely need it to bring on board customers, to be able to recruit great talent, to be able to keep people motivated. I just think that, you know, kind of ability to win people over and to sell is a very underrated but very important skill that an entrepreneur needs. I think probably the thing that a mistake that I made in my last business that I'm definitely doing differently now is just focusing. So it's easy when you start a business, particularly in technology, you can get like, it's really exciting because everybody wants to talk to you and they want you to talk at events and conferences and heaps of things you can go to, and like, you can take so many meetings that you just kind of waste your time and you don't focus on what it is that you actually need to do, which is just like build a great product and talk to customers and get more customers using your product. And so I think like Melanie, who's the founder of Canva, is a very good friend of mine, and she's like, she does not take external meetings ever. So that's her rule. And I've always been like, come on, Mel, you just met this person, like, they're really cool, like, you really like them. She's like, no, I just don't take any meetings, just doesn't leave the office. And so, like, it's just that kind of level of focus is, I think, what you really need in this kind of industry. It's just really just, at the moment, I'm starting a new venture, so, yeah, just not taking any meetings other than talking to customers, building the product. I think, yeah, that would be my focus.
For me, I think, I like to think about, you know, all the different skills that are required to make a business. And I feel like sometimes there's just too much focus on the sort of development side, the coding side of tech products, as if a coder can just deliver this product in isolation. So, you know, while the kind of obvious response to your question is, oh, I wish I could go back 20 years and learn to code, and then what? I would do it all? Like, you know, there is a place for creativity. There is a place for my experience as a mother. You know, a 22-year-old who has not had children would not have been able to, you know, understand how to deal with a 5-year-old or a 4.5-year-old and how to sit in a preschool and screen, you know, effectively, you know, hundreds and hundreds of children. So, you know, as well, I'm not sure that I would change a lot because everything that I've learned and the skills that I've developed in my life have led me to this point. So, you know, there's always things that you can do to improve yourself, but I think we also need to celebrate, you know, the qualities that we have, and women need to value those qualities and look at how they can be, you know, utilized in an entrepreneurial way.
Yeah, and on that note, I mean, wouldn't it be nice to see more female investors than on the other side, who have again had that life experience and can see when you present a product like what you presented, they can kind of relate back to their own experience and see the necessity and usefulness of that. But I guess, I mean, to get more female investors, we need more money with women, and we need to see more female startups and more exits and just more money flowing around the female half of the population, which would be nice. So I am going to, and I'm going to preface this by saying I would find a way to ask exactly the same question of a male panel, because I did want to ask about kids and running businesses and making it all work. But I want to say it in the context of the fact that we certainly know this on Women's Agenda from our research, that we do see a lot of women head towards entrepreneurship at a point in their lives when they're either thinking of having kids or they've got kids, or they've returned to work and see this as an option and as an opportunity to really either acquire the flexibility they need or to chase the passion, or they've got those ideas that come to them at that stage. Having been there myself, I know how challenging it is with very, particularly very small kids that you can't necessarily put in childcare because they are too little.
And I made this little pitch to send it here that maybe if you had that some portion of it with nannies on call, because you might find a bunch of women who would like to come to a place like that and to be able to come in for a few hours and know that their newborn is looked after, because it is really tough for women in business and female entrepreneurs to have really, really young kids at home, and you can't take maternity leave, you can't take that break. So I think, Nicole or Rebecca, because I know that you have got the very little kids at home, or fresh toddlers, I think they might be, or Nicole, yours is almost a toddler. But what did you take a break? What are you doing?
What am I doing? I don't know. That's a good question. I was thinking about this when I got the title of this panel, and it was like, is this a good time to be a entrepreneur, a female tech founder? And I really started to think about what a good time is, and then I started to look at some of the reports and the stats around that, and you know, the Startup Muster report that came out recently, that was, what was it, like 30% or something? 30% of the entire ecosystem of women reported that they identified as being an entrepreneur, that they were involved in some sort of startup, which was a double, like that was double from the year before, which is interesting. And then I started to think about that now in context of being a mum, the reasons why that could have grown, and in context of, is it a good time? So I think it's a better time to be a woman entrepreneur, female entrepreneur. But better doesn't mean that it's good, and it's all in context, it's all relative, better is relative. I think how I manage, I don't really know, you just do, it's just part of your day, it is a huge challenge. It's definitely, you've got to have support around you. I think I'm very lucky that I work with my partner and we job share. But that was an interesting ride in itself, because being in a same-sex relationship meant that both of our careers then, there was no comma or like, you know, dash. It was just a full stop followed by an exclamation mark, and it's horrendous because a lot of women then, I don't think, necessarily want a career as an entrepreneur. I think they're forced into a career as an entrepreneur because mainstream work in society doesn't facilitate women being more than 9 to 5. And if you're not 9 to 5, 5 days a week, then you don't fit in that way. So I don't know. I don't know how I do it. You just do. You make a plan. You find support around you. You share the load. I don't know. We're not having less children because of it, but you just find a way of going out not covered in puree.
Well, I have a 13-month-old girl called Eve. I think I need to say that, but I'm very proud of it, so I'll say it again. So I was really inspired by Marissa Mann. So I remember when, like, she was CEO of Yahoo. And she was all over the press about how she had, you know, she was kind of pregnant when she got her role as CEO, and then she had the baby, she took 3 weeks off, and like she was back at work, and she had a nursery in the office, and then she had twins a couple of years later, and then did the same thing, she was back at work after 3 weeks. So I thought, I can handle this, like I'm just like her, really, like I'm a very determined person.
Maybe a few nannies.
So I thought, that was my plan. I thought if she can do it, I can do it. It was like, she was my role model. And so my plan was that I would, I was running the business as the sole, at that point, CEO. And so I couldn't take a whole lot of time off. We had about 50 staff or something at that stage. And so I worked up until my obstetrician told me I had to stop working. I was 2 days due, in two days before I was due. And then, I came back to work after 4 weeks, and I had the baby in the office, in a nursery, so I turned one of my meeting rooms into a nursery. I did have a full-time babysitter, but in a nursery. So I did that for 4 months, and then my husband took over, and he did the following 6 months, and now she's in daycare and also grandparents and stuff. But what I can say is, it was actually really shit. Like, it was the worst experience. important that we say this though, because Marissa may have made it look really easy. I felt like I wasn't coping. I felt like a failure because I was incredibly tired. I was really emotional because I was still just kind of coming down from having a baby, and still like was carrying my baby weight, and I was breastfeeding, and I was sitting in meetings with, I remember sitting in a shareholder meeting, and I had to breastfeed because the baby was crying. There was nothing I could do. So I had this scarf, and I was like, got like the scarf and the baby, and then I PowerPoint with the other hand. This is just crazy. And so I think that's important that we say it's just not, it is, every woman finds having a baby different. But for me, it was a really hard experience, and I was tired all of the time. I was very emotional. Anyone said anything that upset me, I would just burst into tears. I don't know what the answer is, but I do think we have to share our experiences more openly and not make it look like it's really easy. It says unrealistic expectations for other women. There's one other point that I want to make, which I think is important as we address this kind of gender inequality issues in the workplace more generally, and that's how we handle maternity leave and paternity leave. So my husband, we were very lucky, because he works at a university and they get 6 months full paid leave, whether you're the man or the woman. And so he took 6 months off, and he became the primary carer for kind of from 4 to 6 months he was the stay-at-home dad. But most workplaces don't do that. Most workplaces give 2 weeks to the guy, and 6 months or 3 months to the woman, and then they are allowed to take off 12 months or something. And that is causing a huge problem. Like when you get guys, out over a glass of wine, who work in large organizations, they will say that if they're interviewing a woman who is in their early 30s or their 30s and they have a wedding ring on their finger and they don't have kids, it's a red flag. Like they know that there's a good chance that they're going to have a baby and then take a year off or take 6 months off, but if it's an important role, they're going to have to fill that role with somebody else. And so that is like really discriminating against women of that age group, just as the point when you're about to take leadership positions from getting those roles, because they think there's a chance that you're going to take maternity leave, whether you will or won't. And it's just historically, every time you have a law which is different for men or for women or for different sexual orientations or races or whatever, it's always proven by history to be wrong. And I think that's crazy that in this day it's okay for companies to have different rules for the male primary carer or the female primary carer. It's time that we start seeing like people working at the banks taking 6 months or 12 months off as the dad, and then they kind of when people are going for interviews, they just won't know what to do because they won't know whether this guy going to take time off or is this girl. Just don't know. So that's going to stop discrimination. So I think that's an important thing that we should campaign for.
I do want to add, there is research to suggest that men who are married and who look like they're about to have kids are actually seen as more favourable employees, because it's the idea that as soon as they'll have kids, they'll be more loyal. And so that's a really interesting point that you raise. And I might say for all the founders and business owners here, I think it's also an opportunity to shift the balance. I mean, whether you're having kids or not, who cares, but it's an opportunity to change this culture, particularly the culture around pregnancy discrimination as well, which we're seeing a lot of high profile cases at the moment. Caroline, did you have any points on that? And I might also add that we will go to questions, because I can see hands going up. So we'll go to Caroline first. And then, or did you want to make a point?
Well, the point, I lived in Sweden for a year, and in Sweden, the maternity parental leave, right, is either man or woman. And it must have had an impact on salary fairness as well, because the peers I was working with, the man took it because he got paid more.
Oh, okay. So it encourages, I like that.
This is already 15 years ago.
Yeah.
And so I can only imagine the time I had my research or experience to justify this. But, if that was happening, you can imagine the business owners going, we better make sure the salaries are equal.
Well, I think in Germany, both partners get the same amount of time off paid at their full salary.
They have like an independent woman, they can take up to 40 days.
14 weeks. Where was that?
40 days.
40 days.
Oh, okay.
Okay. Yeah, in Sweden it's a year.
They can do that. And they call it paternal leave and maternity.
Canada's just changed theirs to 2 years.
So.
Wow.
2 years.
Yeah. Males and females.
Justin,
isn't it?
Yeah.
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 Did you want to make a point there,
Carol? I think we're masters of the juggle, and you know, women certainly know how to keep maybe more balls in the air, perhaps. And I think as you know, we try and expand the ecosystem to include more women, that consideration does need to be, you know, made for women in co-working spaces and the like. I've been offered to join many co-working spaces, and I haven't taken up those offers because they're either on the other side of Sydney or, you know, Fishburners. It's never really an option for me because I need to get to the kids, and there's nowhere to park anywhere near Fishburners. And, you know, just for example, I'm not pointing them out for any particular reason, but, you know, as a woman, and if you are the entrepreneur and you're not the primary, you know, breadwinner at that point in time because you're in development or whatever, then, you know, you do need to potentially be, you know, be developing and being a parent and juggling all those things. So I think as we think about expanding the opportunities for women, we also need to make them, you know, the opportunities viable. So that's what,
So any questions or other comments from
the audience? Just before we hand over the floor, can I just say, as we are surrounded by bikes, I think it's a great analogy that women in tech and women entrepreneurs at the moment are a bit like Sydney cyclists. In some areas, the road is smooth and it's safe, and in other areas, it's highly treacherous.
Yeah. Yeah. All right, we've got one at the back. Did you want to grab the microphone?
Excuse my accent, I'm sorry. How did you overcome the fear that you have to be able to be entrepreneur? I would love to have a new book. I don't know, I'm really scared.
Is it the fear of giving up a job or?
Yes, is that both sides.
Is it a financial fear, would you say?
Financial, no. Financial, like how you get yourself into the water and just start swimming.
Jump.
It does sound really cliche, but I think the only way to do it is to just do it. You know, it's like if it were anything else in your life, it was like, oh, you know, should I quit smoking? Let me just smoke one cigarette a day or a whole year and then see if I feel like quitting. You know, you're still a smoker, so I think that you've just got to quit. That was a terrible analogy. Maybe don't take my advice. But just do it. I think there's no other way to say that. I mean, if it's a good idea and you validate it, obviously there's a lot more that goes into it. That's not sort of like jumping in. It's a legitimately terrible idea, then don't do it. But if it is a good idea and you've got belief and you've validated it and you've put a little bit of structure and, you know, worked out your way commercially,
what about, I mean, do you rely like on coaching? Do you have like some guidance from, like you have mentors, role model, but do you have like some guidance from somebody like to be able to coach you? You might go this way or something like that?
Sure. Maybe I'll answer your first question and then I'll answer that question. Okay, because like for me, what gave me the courage is I kind of thought about it as like a regret minimization strategy. So I thought about, when I was trying to decide what I wanted to do, but after this business, I actually kind of got offered a big corporate position, so kind of in that idea again, I thought, well, I could take that. What I wanted to do was think about myself at age 80, and I'm looking back on my life, and I was like, I have had this idea for a new venture, which I'm just about to launch for a long time. So I thought, well,
if I look back at my life when I'm 80, if I like did it and it failed and didn't take this other opportunity, then I would probably regret it maybe a little bit, but not hugely, because at least I would have found out whether it worked or not. If I did it and it was a big success, I wouldn't regret it at all. But if I never tried and I had this idea that I really cared about, then I have this huge regret. And so I think that for me, that's kind of gave me a good framework to which to kind of make a decision to take the risk. But for me, the fear of getting to a point in my life where I couldn't do something like this and look back and really regret it, that is much more scary to me than the idea of failing. So I think it was like kind of prioritizing. Yeah. So that was my answer to the other question is on the mental thing. So another thing that gave me the courage to jump is I always had these tech ideas. Right from back at school, I would write down these kind of .com ideas for things that didn't exist yet. And I never thought that I could do it because I just didn't know how to write code and I didn't look like Mark Zuckerberg. I just didn't think that I was the kind of person that could build a company like that. And then I remember seeing Naomi Simpson from Red Balloon being interviewed on Psychology's Business Builders or something about her story. And I remember thinking, wow, like if she can do it, then I could do it. Like, so having that person, that kind of, that was just like the moment for me where it clicked and I was like, well, maybe I could do that. And yet subsequently I ended up meeting Naomi. She's become a great friend and mentor, and there are a bunch of other people that kind of go to for different things, more so than just having one mentor. I think if you have one mentor, you kind of limit yourself. Also, the ability for like someone who's really, really good to be able to be your mentor is probably quite like, it's unlikely you're gonna find that person because they're probably really busy doing other things. So you're gonna want to get people who are kind of relevant. And I've got someone who's the founder of Google Maps, who I met at a conference, who ended up investing in my business, and he has been my mentor for building a development team. So when I want to hire kind of a new senior engineer, he will always do an interview, even just over Skype, and kind of go, so I know that when I'm hiring people for my development team that they're really, really good, and he'll kind of help me manage the development team. So that's just one example, but there's, like, Naomi, I would talk to about branding and marketing. So I think having different people who you know are really skilled at different areas is kind of the best way to structure a mentor relationship.
Yeah.
Did you?
Oh,
any
questions? Okay, so yeah.
So a quick one for Rebecca, which is you're going to give us the scoop here tonight. We've heard about a lot about the negatives. We've heard a bit about the positives, the ability that women generally can multitask and juggle better than men, the family, and lots of stuff. What are some other things that women just nail better than guys? Like, is it the sales pitch? Is it the relationship scene, seeing how the other team works? Or what is it that you guys just do much better than?
Yeah, what about standing out? Like, if you are one of the few women pitching, is that a bonus? An asset, I should say.
I think it is a good time to to be a woman entrepreneur, and I think people are very my experience is generally that the environment is very supportive. There are so many networks and there is great access to people to lend support. I think women are great organisers, and that is a real skill. I think there's lots of skills that are shared between both men and women. I'm not sure that we have to, say that we're better at this or better at that. I think the reality is that we're all good at different things, and our passion in certain areas can drive a business as successfully as a man's passion can. My business is a social impact business. I'm about, detecting children with hearing loss to ensure that they can have, a full and rewarding life. Maybe, there's more women doing things in the social impact space and recognizing that, or putting need over, chasing that $1 billion exit, so which is often lauded as, you know, what you should be aiming for, and or as the mark of success. Well, it's not something that I, you know, it's not a carrot dangling in front of my nose. It's, you know, I want to have the happy, I want to be able to look back on my past and die peacefully knowing that, you know, I've been fulfilled and I've been challenged and I continue to learn, and at the same time I've had an impact, a positive impact on the world.
I think, so it's hard to really say when I'm in general, again, without going and becoming a man and kind of seeing what I do differently. I don't really know, but it's one thing I've noticed that I'm quite good at, and I've noticed that in general, more women I've noticed are good at this, which is empathy. Which is having, and that's really useful, having empathy with the customer. So when I'm doing the user interviews, really understanding what people are actually saying, what their problem actually is and what it is that they really want to achieve. So, yeah, I don't know if that's a female thing. I have a sense that maybe it is to some extent. Yeah, maybe we're slightly better at kind of really understanding what it is that people really want, really listening and kind of reading all of the other kind of signals people are giving off. And that has definitely helped in terms of product design. And in terms of standing out, I think that is a really good point. Like that night at St. The Angels, in the men's club, I was the only person that raised capital. I raised like $300,000 that night. And I do think that it does help you. I think that it does potentially, when you're at an event and you're pitching and all the others, you know, kind of like white men in their 30s, and just like, and you're the only woman or one of the few women, it does definitely help you stand out. I think it also helps you for press. Like often, press are looking for stories that feature women, or that they need photographs, the editors want photographs of women. So I do think that it's helped us kind of raise the profile of the business through having a kind of just press wanting to write stories about female founders.
Yeah, I'm sure that you told me this, Rebecca, that with the AFR that seems to have a real problem with trying to find women, to quote. And when you can click through the Australian Financial Review and you will not find any women. I think you mentioned to me that it's great when you can get a quote there because you end up on the front page. Because they're like, yes, we found a woman, so let's put her on the front. And I think it's a really good point. It's something that you need to get in that circle of press. And once you're in there, they'll keep coming back to you.
I think it's twofold. I think the exciting part is that we're on the precipice of change, and that's exciting because it's bringing out a lot of amazing stories and a lot of amazing community, and I think that that's an exciting period of time to be both witness to and contribute to. And, you know, especially being a mum to a daughter as well. I feel now like a lot more pressure and importance on where we are now, where we need to be and where we have been. But I don't think that it's about what women do better. I think it's about what we do better collectively as a whole. You know, this is an ecosystem, it's a community, and we all need to be a part of it to make it thrive. And I think that that's the part that is missing a little bit now, but it's that we are outliers and we are standing out, and that is exciting, and you know, we're cashing in on it and doing what we can to bring that message to the forefront. But it's not productive long term to building a diverse and inclusive ecosystem and society that represents and brings out the best in everybody.
Do we have any final questions or comments?
I do. I've got a question. I've got two daughters, and I want to set them up as best as possible, as any good parent would want to do. What emphasis do you guys place on education? Because we're going through the phase at the moment of our eldest is 10, and we're deciding, do we go private, do we go public? The affordability is a whole other story, but I'm just going to anticipate we will be able to afford it. All the rest, but the question is simple. What emphasis do you place on education?
I don't think that public or private really matter, to be honest, on the outcome. I think, you know, there are many
thought out there. And having gone through both systems, I think it's about the example that you set and what you foster in your daughter and what language you use around your daughters to encourage them to be whatever it is that they want to be. And there's a whole lot of unintentional genderized things. It's like, you know, someone will go to the doctor and you'll automatically say, what did he say? And it's, you know, and I catch myself doing it all the time. And it horrifies me how just subconscious it is. So I don't think it's entirely about education. I think it's about the worldview that you shape and create for them.
Can I add a little answer in there? I know that I'm not telling you, but I'm going to add this because I interviewed Madonna King this morning and she's written a book called Being 14, and it's about girls at that age of being 14. I don't know if any girls in the room, women in the room I should say, can remember being 14, but I remember it and it really sucked. It is so hard. And I think that book is really valuable. It looks at, and I think it's also a conversation relevant to everything that we're talking about tonight, is some of the pressures we place on girls, because we're girls' mothers our age at that point where we are trying to have it all, and that's all become an opportunity. But then we try and place that on those young girls and say, you know, you can go and play one of 28 different sports, make sure you're the best at it, you can go and be on the debating team, make sure you go and beat the boys, you can go and get into STEM and get all encouraged into all these different fields, but make sure you're still up there academically, and, you know, make sure you've got their friends and their peers and happy on social media and everything. So the point was that we created all these opportunities for girls, but we put too much pressure on them at the same time, and they're just getting sucked in at this age of 14 particularly. So, yeah, just a book to check out, Being 14.
Being 14,
by Madonna King. Yeah.
Just on the point about, like, subconsciously saying he, we have a rule in our house that we subconsciously say she for everything, because we noticed that we were doing it as well, so... There was a court case that we attended, and we just, everybody talked about the judge as being a he, and then turned up and it was just like, what's he going to think? And then you turn up and it's like, oh, it's a woman. You just got to be, so we're just okay, every time there's like a bad driver, we're not going to go, we're not going to say he, like, you can say, what's she doing? You know, like, I just think for a daughter, it's kind of good to get into that mindset. There was one other thing, public, private, one thing that I think did make a difference for me, although it's just my personal experience, was that I did think that going to a girls' secondary school, I definitely kind of came out of my shell in secondary school. I think that had a bit to do with not having boys around. I just felt a lot more comfortable in my own skin. But I think that is a personal thing, but that did make a difference for me.
Can I just make a comment about that? In my experience, the most successful women that I've come across professionally and in entrepreneurship have been somewhat rebellious, and I actually think that that is the trait that you need to encourage in a young girl, and I think that girls need that, and I also think that women here need this, because I'm so sick of seeing incredibly capable women who are often more capable than men, not get in roles that are much more junior from what men are.
Yeah, or seeing high-achieving girls in high school being encouraged to go into law or medicine because they're getting those marks.
Absolutely.
And, you know, when maybe they should be encouraged into entrepreneurship or into more rebellious careers or something.
But does rebellion come from public school or private school?
I agree to both.
Yeah.
I think that's a personal thing. I think it's something you foster in a child. I don't think it's about the school that you go to. I think that happens at home. And it's encouraging your daughter to question the world and to interrogate unfairness in the world.
There's that a Supreme Court, I cannot remember her name, and she had no tertiary, like no formal education. I don't even think she finished high school, and then she ended up going to uni, and now she's gone.
As a mother of three, of a 23-year-old, a 13-year-old, and an almost 10-year-old, I
do think there are occasions where it matters, and it depends on the child. And unfortunately, we have this terrible situation in Australia where you have to decide at birth, you know, at the moment of birth, literally, you know, what school you want to put your child down for, and, you know, it's really counterproductive. There are children that need educational support, and sometimes that's better delivered through a private school. And there's children who will flourish in any environment. So So you cannot make, and you can't take a poll on what's going to be right for your child. You have to determine, you know, based on the needs of your child and what will help your child flourish, you know, what's the right option for your child. That's my opinion. And having put two children, or having two children in high school, through high school.
Can I say one final point about girls? It's not sort of an education, but it's about being now a mother of a daughter as well. Things that I'm noticing is that is sort of the way that women are portrayed in the media. So, example was that I was walking through the airport. This is kind of a story from last year now, but I was walking through Melbourne Airport and I noticed this new Qantas campaign that had just been launched. And there was banners of people who worked at Qantas, and there was like a big picture of this kind of like engineer guy who was like smiling at a quote about what it was like to work at Qantas. And there was an air traffic controller guy, and he said, you know, every second counts, and I'm one of the guys who does the counting. And there was this like grey-haired old pilot man, and he said something. And then there was a woman, and she was like holding a tray, saying, I enjoy welcoming people back to the lounge. And it was just like all of the, there was four careers, and like all the way through the airport, there was just banner up, these four banners just being repeated. And I was like, what message does that send to young girls walking through the airport? About what a career they should aspire to, that's what a pilot looks like, or that's what an engineer looks like. And I think I took photos of all the banners, I posted them on social media, and just exploded, people started posting them everywhere. We ended up getting to the CEO through the Male Champions of Change, got to him, and they cancelled, they got the campaign taken down. So I think like when we see that kind of thing, it's really like our responsibility now to call it out and say that's just, it's just not on. That's probably just some episode we hadn't said it to think about it, but it's really important that.
Yeah, because it's probably,
Like, I don't want my daughter thinking that that's what a pilot looks like. You know, a pilot could be a woman or it could be a man, and they need to see examples of both.
So we did have. Think. Okay, so let's go two more questions, and then I think we'll have some time for everyone to talk to the panelists anyway.
Hi, my name is Oliver. I just wanted to talk about solutions. We've talked a lot about inequality in the workplace and in entrepreneurship and tech. Are there any movements or any organizations that we as an audience could get involved in to, which would help drive change?
Oh, I think change can happen, you know, you can initiate change. You know, every man can view, you know, a conversation with a woman in the same way that they view a conversation with a man. And you know, and equally, I think women also need to view conversations with women, you know, in the same way that they view a conversation with a man. I think, you know, that we're equally guilty of, you know, of devaluing, you know, women in many respects. So I think, yeah, I think change can happen at a grassroots level. There's some great organisations, like I'm a Springboard alumni. And you know, an accelerator program set up specifically for women, and that's, you know, doing great things here and overseas. And yeah, there's generally lots of support. But I think the most important thing you can do, yeah, is just, you know, be engaged and treat all the women that you meet, you know, in a positive, productive way.
I think being aware
of what the problems are as well, and just, you know, exactly what you were saying about noticing what campaigns look like and just starting to sort of be aware of what the balance looks like as well.
Get on social media and that's it.
Read Women's Agenda.
I think that they're exactly like a campaign, and I mean, this is what we do a lot. We see a lot of men and women starting to do it, is they're calling out, like when you see male panels, all male panels happening, or just really male-heavy tech events or conferences, just make a point about it, because the organisers will change it, and that affects
change. It is changing. You know, the panels were very diverse, and there was a consciousness around diversity. So I think, you know, we're on the road, and we just keep pedaling.
I just add a little story on that. Definitely calling out all male panels is a big thing. There was a government startup competition last year, and I just got kind of the press release about it. I knew the company that was putting it on, and it was an all male judging panel. And I thought, what message does that send? Like, this is a government funded competition, and these girls are going to turn up to a panel all judged by men. So I wrote to the organisation and said, look, you know, guys, you've got no women on the panel. What are you doing? Like, this is and then I got a response back saying, I can't find anyone. We tried, blah, 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 blah. And so I forwarded it to, and I like really made up Malcolm Turnbull's email address. And I forwarded this email and said, hey Malcolm, great to chat to you at this thing that I knew he was at, that was kind of at, but I didn't chat to him. And just really start a conversation about women in tech. I just wanted to raise your awareness of them. Like, I copied the thing, the other guy that was running it. And then he like responded saying, we have solved this. So I think like, you've got to like,
It's just my idea, but you've got to do whatever it takes to get the solution.
All right, so we did have one final question. Well, thank you to our panelists, and thank you all for joining me.
I don't know about you, but there are a million ideas buzzing around in my head right now. When you're seeing, you're supposed to like, draw on some witty comment and sum up things nicely, but there are just so many things that have come up that I don't really feel like I have one of those, which makes me grateful that we're going into a period of networking drinks now for the next half hour or so. So all those things that are churning in all of your heads, please do chat with each other, chat with these incredible role models that we have in front of us here. We do need to say a massive thank you to you for giving up your time as well. I think giving back in the ecosystem is a massive thing. And I know you're asked to do it a lot, and we're really grateful for that. And especially on topics like this, it's really incredible for somebody early in their career, like me and others who are here, to really be encouraged at what you've done and where we're heading and where we're going. So that upward trajectory, I'm glad that you finished on that, Carolyn. So please do join me in giving a massive thank you to all the panellists. We do have a little gift for them as a token of our appreciation. And so please give them another round of applause. So there's also a couple of other thank yous that we need to make. One of them is to Jono over here from North City Innovation Network for pulling this whole thing together and making it happen. He's in a bazillion different directions, doing so much to pull what's happening over the bridge together. And so we're grateful that you have chosen to dedicate your time to an event like this. So thank you, Jono. And also to the team here at Working. So we've got Tom and Barrett and Lucy around somewhere down the back. Thank you guys for hosting us so beautifully. Such a cool space. And for the tour you gave it earlier to a lot of people who came in. Really exciting. Congratulations on all that you're doing here. It's really exciting. So thank you.
Well, Barrett will give you presentations as well, but I also wanted to add my thanks to Lydia. And I just wanted to just draw a long bow here. There's five of you, if I include moderator, panelists, and MC. And I draw on the analogy of, so just remember five, put that away. And I draw on the analogy of Mother's Day. I have always had an objection to things like Mother's Day and Father's Day. This is this duality of, we have a special day for mothers, but we should always appreciate, you know, Mother's Day should be 365 days of the year. So we shouldn't forget Mother's Day for the other 364 days. So with those two concepts in your head, I'd like to present each of you a book, which is The Five Forget Mother's Day.
Thank you.
And also a special gift for, she was going to get it for actually standing up and being counted as well. But for the woman who's often behind these events, yes, Lucy, I'm looking at you.
Amazing. Well, that draws us to the close of the formal part of the evening, but there certainly is a more informal part. There's still some food there, there's still some drinks to be had.
please enjoy connecting with each other, connecting with our panellists for as long as they can stick around before they go home to see beautiful babies. And we will see you all hopefully at another event on the shore soon. Thanks for coming.